person is guilty of reckless manslaughter if he recklessly causes the death of another person. In order for you to find defendant guilty of reckless manslaughter, the state is required to prove each of the following elements beyond a reasonable doubt. One, that defendant caused Richard Doody's death, and two, that defendant did so recklessly. One element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is the defendant acted recklessly. A person who causes another's death does so recklessly when he is aware of and consciously disregards a substantial and unjustifiable risk that death will result from his conduct. The risk must be of such a nature and degree that, considering the nature and purpose of defendant's conduct and the circumstances known to defendant, his disregard of that risk is a gross deviation from the standard of conduct that a reasonable person would follow in the same situation. In other words, you must find the defendant was aware of and consciously disregarded the risk of causing death. If you find the defendant was aware of and disregarded the risk of causing death, you must determine whether the risk that he disregarded was substantial and unjustifiable. In doing so, you must consider the nature and purpose of defendant's conduct and the circumstances known to defendant, and you must determine whether, in light of those factors, defendant's disregard of that risk was a gross deviation from the conduct a reasonable person would have observed in defendant's situation. The other element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that defendant caused Richard Doody's death. You must find that Richard Doody would not have died but for defendant's conduct. If, after consideration of all the evidence, you are convinced that the state has proved beyond a reasonable doubt the defendant recklessly caused Richard Doody's death, then your verdict must be guilty of reckless manslaughter. If, however, after consideration of all the evidence, you are not convinced that the state has proved beyond a reasonable doubt that defendant recklessly caused Richard Doody's death, you must find defendant not guilty of reckless manslaughter. The indictment charges that the defendant has committed the crime of murder. The defendant contends that if the state proves he used or threatened to use force upon Richard Doody, that such force was justifiably used for his self-protection. The statute reads, "The use of force upon or toward another person is justifiable when the actor reasonably believes that such force is immediately necessary for the purpose of protecting himself against the use of unlawful force by such person on the present occasion." In other words, self-defense is the right of a person to defend against any unlawful force. Self-defense is also the right of a person to defend against seriously threatened unlawful force that is actually pending or reasonably anticipated. When a person is in imminent danger of bodily harm, the person has the right to use force, or even deadly force, when that force is necessary to prevent the use against him of unlawful force. The force used by the defendant must not be significantly greater than and must be proportionate to the unlawful force threatened or used against the defendant. Unlawful force is defined as force used against a person without the person's consent in such a way that the action would be a civil wrong or a criminal offense. If the force used by the defendant was not immediately necessary for the defendant's protection, or if the force used by the defendant was disproportionate in its intensity, then the use of such force by the defendant was not justified, and the self-defense claim fails. There are different levels of force that a person may use in his own defense to prevent unlawful harm. The defendant can only use that amount of, or degree of force that he reasonably believes is necessary to protect himself against harm. If the defendant is attempting to protect himself against exposure to death or the substantial danger of serious bodily harm, he may resort to the use of deadly force. Otherwise, he may only resort to non-deadly force. Use of deadly force may be justified only to defend against force or the threat of force of nearly equal severity and is not justifiable unless the defendant reasonably believes that such force is necessary to protect himself bodily harm. By serious bodily harm, we mean an injury that creates a substantial risk of death, or which causes serious permanent disfigurement, or which causes a protracted loss or impairment of the function of any bodily member or organ. For example, if one were to purposely fire a firearm in the direction of another person, that would be an example of deadly force. A mere threat with a firearm, however, intended only to make the victim of the threat believe that the defendant will use the firearm if necessary, is not an example of deadly force. One cannot respond with deadly force to a threat of, or even an actual minor attack. For example, a slap or an imminent threat of being pushed in a crowd would not ordinarily justify the use of deadly force to defend against such unlawful conduct. Therefore, you must first determine whether the defendant used deadly force. If you find that the defendant did so, then you must determine if the defendant reasonably believed he had to use deadly force to defend against the unlawful conduct of another. A reasonable belief is one which would be held by a person of ordinary prudence and intelligence situated as this defendant was. Self-defense exonerates a person who uses force in the reasonable belief that such action was necessary to prevent his or her death or serious injury, even though this belief was later proven mistaken. Accordingly, the law requires only a reasonable, not necessarily a correct judgment. Even if you find that the use of deadly force was reasonable, there are limitations on the use of deadly force. If you find that the defendant, with the purpose of causing death or serious bodily harm to another person, provoked or incited the use of force against himself in the same encounter, then the defense is not available to him. If you find the defendant knew that he could avoid the necessity of using deadly force by retreating, provided that the defendant knew he could do so with complete safety, then the defense is not available to him. A dwelling includes a porch or other similar structure. In your inquiry as to whether a defendant who resorted to deadly force knew an opportunity to retreat with complete safety was available, the total circumstances, including the attendant excitement accompanying the situation, must be considered. The state has the burden to prove to you beyond a reasonable doubt that the defense of self-defense is untrue. The defense only applies if all the conditions or elements previously described exist. The defense must be rejected if the state disproves any of the conditions beyond a reasonable doubt. The same theory applies to the issue of retreat. Remember that the obligation of the defendant to retreat only arises if you find that the defendant resorts to the use of deadly force. If the defendant does not resort to the use of deadly force, one who was unlawfully attacked may hold his position and not retreat, whether the attack upon him is by deadly force or some lesser force. Burden of proof is upon the state to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant knew he could have retreated with complete safety. If the state carries its burden, then you must disallow the defense. If the state does not satisfy this burden, then you have a reasonable doubt, then it must be resolved in favor of the defendant, and you must allow the claim of self-defense and acquit the defendant. Counts 2, 4, and 5 of the indictment charges the defendant, Conrad R. Sipa, with the crime of possession of a weapon with a purpose to use it unlawfully against the person or property of another. The statute on which this count of the indictment is based reads in pertinent part: a person who is in possession of any weapon with a purpose to use it unlawfully against the person or property of another is guilty of a crime. In order for you to find the defendant guilty of this charge, the state has the burden of proving beyond a reasonable doubt each of the four following elements. One, any or all of exhibits 90, S90A, S91A, S93A, S94A, and S95A are weapons. Just so that you have context. golf club and the silver serrated knife. Two, defendant possessed any or all of these weapons. Three, defendant possessed any or all of the weapons with the purpose to use them against the person or property of another. Four, defendant's purpose was to use any or all of the weapons unlawfully. The first element that the defendant, the first element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that any or all of these exhibits are weapons. A weapon is anything readily capable of lethal use or of inflicting serious bodily injury. Serious bodily injury means injury which creates a substantial risk of death or which causes serious permanent disfigurement or protracted loss or impairment of the function of any bodily member or organ. It is possible that a lamp, golf club, and or knife are not normally considered weapons. If, however, the state establishes beyond a reasonable doubt that any of these objects is capable of being used to inflict serious bodily harm or death, it may be considered a weapon. The second element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that the defendant possessed any of the weapons alleged. To possess an item under the law, one must have a knowing, intentional control of that item, accompanied by a knowledge of its character. So, a person who possesses an item, such as a lamp, golf club, and/or a knife, must know or be aware that he possesses it, and he must know what it is he possesses or controls, again, a lamp, a golf club, or a knife. In other words, to possess an item, one must knowingly procure or receive an item or be aware of his control thereof for a sufficient period of time to have been able to relinquish his control if he chose to do so. Excuse me. The state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that a possessor acted knowingly in possessing the item. A person acts knowingly with respect to the nature of his conduct or the attendant circumstances if he is aware that his conduct is of that nature or that such circumstances exist or he is aware of the high probability of their existence. A person acts knowingly as to a result of his conduct if he is aware that it is practically certain that the conduct will cause such a result. Knowing with knowledge or equivalent terms have the same meaning. Knowledge is a condition of the mind. It cannot be seen. It can only be determined by inferences from conduct, words, or acts. Therefore, it's not necessary for the state to produce witnesses to testify that a particular defendant stated, for example, that he acted with knowledge when he had control over a particular thing. It is within your power to find that proof of knowledge has been furnished beyond a reasonable doubt by inference, which may arise from the nature of the acts and surrounding circumstances. A person may possess a lamp, golf club, and or knife, even though it was not physically on his person at the time of the arrest, if he had, in fact, at some time prior to his arrest, had control over it. Possession means a conscious, knowing possession, either actual or constructive. A person is in actual possession of an item when he knows first what it is, that is, that he has knowledge of its character, and second, knowingly, has it on his person at any given time. The third element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is the defendant's purpose in possessing each object was to use each object as a weapon against the person or property of another. Purpose is a condition of the mind which cannot be seen and can only be determined by inferences from conducts, words, or acts. In determining the defendant's purpose in possessing the weapons, you may consider that a person acts purposely with respect to the nature of his conduct or a result of his conduct if it is the person's conscious object to engage in conduct of that nature or to cause such a result. That is, a person acts purposely if he means to act in a certain way or to cause a certain result. A person acts purposely with respect to attendant circumstances if the person is aware of the existence of such circumstances or believes or hopes that they exist. The defendant's purpose or conscious objective to use the weapon against the person or property of another may be found to exist at any time he is in possession of the object and need not have been the defendant's original purpose in possessing the object. The fourth element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that the defendant had a purpose to use each weapon in a manner that was prohibited by law. I have already defined purpose for you. requires that you find that the state has proven beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant possessed the specific weapon addressed in each respective count of the indictment. So there's a separate count for each item. With the conscious objective, design, or specific intent to use it against the property or person of another in an unlawful manner as charged in the indictment and not for some other purpose. An object may be possessed for an innocent or lawful purpose. However, an innocent or lawful purpose or possession of the weapon or item may change. It may become unlawful and a violation of this statute. The state need not prove defendant's original purpose of possessing the weapon. The state need only prove beyond a reasonable doubt that defendant's purpose at the time specified he possessed it was to use it unlawfully against the person or property of another. In this case, the state contends that the defendant's unlawful purpose in possessing each weapon was to inflict serious bodily injury upon and or cause the death of Richard Doody. You must not rely upon your own notions of the unlawfulness of some other undescribed purpose of defending. Rather, you must consider whether the state has proved the specific unlawful purpose charged. The unlawful purpose alleged by the state may be inferred from all of this said or done and from all of the surrounding circumstances of this case. However, the state need not prove that defendant accomplished his unlawful purpose of using the weapon. I've already told you that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that defendant had an unlawful purpose at the time in question. If you find that the defendant had a lawful purpose, for example, to use the knife, lamp, and or golf club to protect himself against the use of unlawful force, or if you have a reasonable doubt as to the defendant's purpose, then the state has failed to carry its burden of proof on this element beyond a reasonable doubt. I instruct you that for purposes of this offense, if defendant honestly believed that he needed to use a knife, lamp, and or golf club to protect himself, the law does not require that this belief be reasonable. In other words, if defendant had an honest, though unreasonable, belief that he needed to use the weapon to protect himself, this negates the purposeful mental state required for this offense. Earlier in the charge, I instructed you on the concept of self-defense as it applies to the offenses of murder, passion provocation, aggravated manslaughter, and reckless manslaughter. The concept of self-defense, as it applies to those offenses, is different than that of protective purpose that applies to these counts of the indictment. And when applied to those offenses, self-defense requires the defendant to have an honest and a reasonable belief in the need to use force. If you are satisfied beyond a reasonable doubt that the state's presented the elements of these offenses as I have defined them, then you must find defendant guilty. However, if you find that the state has failed to prove beyond a reasonable doubt any of the elements of these offenses as I have defined them and as separately charged in counts 2, 4, and 5 of the indictment, then you must find defendant not guilty. The defendant is charged with knowingly having his possession a weapon. Specifically, count 3 alleges that Conrad R. Sipa, between the dates of November 21, 2015 and November 23, 2015, in the borough of Barnegat Light, knowingly did possess a certain weapon, that is a knife, under circumstances not manifestly appropriate for such lawful uses as it may have. That section of our statutes provides in the pertinent part, any person who knowingly has in his possession any other weapon under circumstances not manifestly appropriate for such lawful uses as it may have is guilty of a crime. In order to convict the defendant of this crime, the state must prove the following elements beyond a reasonable doubt. That first element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that S95A, the silver knife, is a weapon. A weapon is anything readily capable of lethal use or of inflicting serious bodily injury. The second element that the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt is that the weapon was knowingly possessed by the defendant at the time and place alleged. Here, the state alleges that defendant possessed the weapon at Richard Doody's residence at 2204 Central Avenue in Barnegat Light sometime between the dates of November 21, 2015 and November 23, 2015. Person acts knowingly with respect to the nature of his conduct or the attendant circumstances if he's aware that the conduct is of that nature or that such circumstances exist where the person is aware of a high probability of their existence. A person acts knowingly with respect to a result of the conduct if he is aware that it is practically certain that the conduct will cause a result. Knowing with knowledge or equivalent terms have the same meaning. Again, knowledge is a condition of the mind. It cannot be seen. It can only be determined by inferences from defendant's conducts, words, or acts. A state of mind is rarely susceptible of direct proof, but must ordinarily be inferred from the facts. Therefore, it's not necessary that the state produce witnesses to testify that an accused had a certain state of mind when he did the particular thing. It's within your power to find that such proof has been furnished